happy Monday to all of you at home. Let's crack the net with what is trending in the National Hockey League. We'll start with the Tampa Bay Lightning, because my goodness, they had a game against the Hawks. They set a record for shots in a period with 33 and a franchise record for shots in a single game with 55.
Talk about the Lightning. How about Cam Ward, though? That was absolutely crazy. But the Lightning, they're just turning it up. They just started a little bit of a slow start, I'd say, to their season, but they ramped it up, and that second period was incredible, to say the least.
Yeah, I mean, it was a shooting gallery, literally, in the Blackhawks zone in the second period. Cam Ward did the best he could to try to keep it as close as he could. But right now, Chicago Blackhawks, it's been a pretty good start for them. But they're giving up a lot of shots and a lot of goals, and they've got to find a way to kind of stem that. It was a second of a back-to-back, but it was also, I believe, a second of a back-to-back for the Wild, the Lightning as well. They were playing the Wild the night before. They were a little incensed probably with losing an overtime to Mini, but Chicago's got to tighten it up, clearly. And for Tampa, a nice job there on the road.
Put everything to the net, and that's usually a coach's game plan. And when you get that many shots, you're just not missing the net. How many times have we watched games and players are shooting around screens or trying to hit their spot, and they miss the net? Well, Tampa wasn't missing the net. And you can have a good game by getting 33 shots in a game, let alone a period. So that was absolutely incredible.
Yeah, how many games are the teams don't have 33 shots? You're right, in a whole game. But substantially less.
We talk about Johnny Gaudreau a lot on this show for good reason. Got his 100th career goal last week, and not just his 300th point in just his 320th game. This kid's incredible.
Yeah, and Dave and I were talking, we were all talking about it in the meeting this morning, that 300 points in 320 games in this NHL, particularly when you're a fourth round draft pick who's not the biggest guy in the world and not everybody thought you'd be able to play at this level. This guy is something special. You see him there, the Flames tweeted it out, he's got the puck there, and always like to see these Jersey kids doing well, and he comes home to the New York area and against the Rangers ends up with that 300th point. But Dave, it's hard to do this now, what he's doing.
Oh my gosh, it's extremely hard to do it. Think back in the 80s when how many point per game guys were there? How many 100 point players were there in a season? In today's stats, it's just not there. And this is pretty good company for the Calgary Flames, going way back to Kent Nilsson. Joe Nieuwendyk went over 50 in his rookie year. Another 50 goal scorer, Theo Fleury, and Gary Suter is coming up on 319 points here. His nephew will be coming up on his 1,000th game with Minnesota. But that's pretty good numbers right there for Johnny Gaudreau. The thing about Johnny Gaudreau, though, in the 4 years that he's been in Calgary, not counting the one game he can't play for BC when he stepped into his first year pro, he's only missed 17 games. Yeah. And that's impressive. So it's one thing to say that, yes, he's a smaller player. He's 165 pounds at best. That's what he's listed at 5'9". There was some talk earlier this season when he was getting tossed around by Charlie McAvoy that he's going to have to change his game because if he's going to take hits like this, he might get more injuries than the team wants him to get. But guess what? When you put up that many points, he's almost a point per game guy at 5'9" on a team that can struggle to score points. And at one, a few years ago, it was pretty much his line was the only line scoring. So very impressive for Johnny Gaudreau. And I don't see it stopping anything.
No, he's so much fun to watch.
So fun.
He's one of the more you pay to see a guy like that. He's fun to watch.
Well, over the weekend, there's a lot of highlights that we don't necessarily get to talk about come Monday morning. But the one goal you certainly wanted to take a look at when we entered the meeting this morning was Stone.
Yeah, Mark Stone in overtime for the Ottawa Senators here. And this is just a great one-timer. I mean, Dave, you played in a million games. You've been watching a lot of games. I mean, this is a shot right here.
This is a shot. I love the way he gets set up, though. He just pulls off, goes to the middle, pushes off. Stone's got a great release. He's got a long stick, and he gets a lot of torque in that shot. I keep watching it, I still say, did it go through Carey Price? Did it go around Carey Price? But it is amazing because when you talk to young players, they say, I always say you aim with your eyes. So if you're looking, your eyes are going to go where the puck goes. Well, he's thinking, I'm looking at Carey Price's mid-body as Price moves across the net. So Stone winds up. He's not looking at an open part of the net. He's actually looking at a part of the net that's covered. And he's got to shoot to that spot, and Price slides too far, and it goes in. But an absolute rocket of a
rocket.
It was a laser.
Those two teams, both of them have been surprising this year, and, both get a point. It goes to overtime, and Ottawa gets the extra point. But, Mark Stone's a good player. Probably don't talk about him enough, Maybe because he's in Ottawa and it hasn't been good the last couple of year and a half or so now.
I think we'll be talking about him as the season moves along for
different reasons.
UFA, yes, because he is going to get a payday, well deserving.
Either there or somewhere else.
Yes, love it when those goals, though, those game winners make the ding. Nobody has put more shots on goal to start this season than the Carolina Hurricanes, who are averaging over 40 per game. They're currently first in the Metro in this early season. They take on the Red Wings tonight in Detroit. For more, we bring in Mike Maniscalco. Let's start with Sebastian Aho, who's extended his point streak to 8 games through the start of the season. What has he had to say about how he's taken the next step in this league? All right.
Well, I think we're frozen. Hi, Jackie. We're good.
Hi, there we go. All right. It's
basically,
Monday, right?
Basically, for Sebastian, what it's come down to is he has pretty much gotten comfortable playing in the center position, and it took him a while to get there, but he's one of those players that you can definitely count on to want to get better. He's working with Rod Brind'Amour about getting better, and that's why we're seeing the results early on, as he's tied Victor Rask for the Hurricanes record to start a season with points in a game at 8, and he's 3 behind Ron Francis for the franchise record back in the Hartford days. But he's really adjusted well game by game. He told me that the other day. I asked him, what's the biggest difference? He just says every game he gets a little bit more comfortable, and that's been the big reason why we're seeing Sebastian Aho put up the points like we have this October, like we haven't seen in previous Octobers.
+9 rating, too, pretty good for a young offensive player. Elsewhere, Andrei Svechnikov is another reason the Hurricanes' fast start to the season has been somewhat of a successful one. What has Rod Brind'Amour said about the rookie's development and transition into the league?
Well, he just said it today, and every time he's asked about him, it's the fact that Andre wants to learn. He hasn't come into this league thinking he knows everything, and Rod Brind'Amour has been impressed with, just from day one of training camp, and you can go all the way back to prospect camp, how Andrei Svechnikov has wanted to get better every day. He always has a question if there's something that he's not sure of. He wants to know where he should be. And I think that's what's impressed his head coach the most about what Andrei Svechnikov has brought to the table. And, you know, once he starts figuring out a little bit more of how to play without the puck, I think we're going to see him become even more dynamic in this season. And he's a really smart player. He was excited about playing Detroit tonight. Of course, he would have liked to play against his brother, but his brother had successful knee surgery 5 days ago. But he did spend some time with his family last night. So I might see Andre be a little bit fired up tonight to play against his brother's team, even though his brother isn't in the lineup.
Yeah, I'm sure Canes fans would love to see that. A lot of young talent on that team. They look to take it to the Detroit Red Wings tonight. Thanks for this, Mike. All right, gentlemen, here is a look at the 3 players who will look to make it 9 game point streaks to start the season. Nathan MacKinnon, Mikko Rantanen, and teammates, they help each other out quite a bit in the points department. Sebastian Aho will look to do that tonight against the Red Wings. I'd say he's got a pretty good shot.
I think they both are. These guys are having tremendous seasons, yeah. And Sebastian Aho, you know, it's interesting. He's got a new line mate, Michael Ferland. Yeah. Michael Ferland has brought a lot to his line. We've seen Sebastian Aho play the center position in the international game. He was dominant at the World Junior level. He's been very good at the World Championship at the men's level. He's just starting to mature into a bona fide center iceman. And you've got to give him credit. You've got to give the coaching staff credit to put Sebastian Aho in the middle when he was needed. They needed a centerman. They put him in the middle, his natural position, and he's just absolutely taken off. Very interesting to see if he can catch the franchise leader, Ronnie Francis. In this one, can you name Ronnie Francis' wingers? Way back then, 4 or 5. Those were the days.
Yeah,
it's like my rookie year back then. That's how it goes way back.
Yeah.
Don't ask me to name them, but that's an honor.
I was going to say, don't ask me to name them.
I'm sure Kevin Dineen's one of them.
Yeah,
Pat Verbeek might have been the other one.
Might have been,
even though they were both right shots. But when you look at when you've got an opportunity to set a franchise mark, you're right behind a franchise mark, which both Rantanen and MacKinnon are in the same situation as they go for the Avs Nordiques franchise mark held by Sakic, and that's a teammate thing held by Sakic and Anton Stastny way back when, 88-89. But it's interesting that is to get off to such a great start, to have a player, your number one centerman get off to is a great start, is usually a good indication your team is going to be doing well. Carolina has really flourished under Rod Brind'Amour, but it's Sebastian Aho's, I think, maturing – time to step in to be a leader in the National Hockey League, and he's in a great role where he's at. And I can remember watching him playing in the World Juniors, and he was absolutely dominant. He's been dominant player at the top of his age group, whether it's U18, at the World Juniors, the U20s, and even at the World Championship, he was good. So give him some time in the men's game in the National Hockey League, and I'm sure we'll see him over the years creep into the top 20 in scoring regularly.
Yeah, it's just the maturation process. I mean, I think we saw the same thing with Evgeny Kuznetsov with the Washington Capitals. He kind of came up the ranks. We remember him playing the World Juniors, same kind of thing.
Same thing, yes.
I don't know if Aho is going to get to that, quite that level, but he's a very good player. Maybe he will. And the fact that Michael Ferland is there, too, I agree with you. He adds a little bit of sandpaper, a little bit of physical play to open up things a little bit. I think he's been a really nice addition for the Hurricanes, a good fit.
And then MacKinnon and Rantanen both took big steps forward last season, and they just seem to be carrying on from everything that they were doing last year. And I still feel like Rantanen's slightly underrated.
You're probably right, but MacKinnon is such a big personality there, and also Landeskog is the team captain. So I think Mikko likes it that way. He's okay with just going about his business, doing his thing. Last week we had Gabriel Landeskog on, and he talked just about just like that. He's one of these guys that just comes and plays, and he has fun with his teammates, and that's a great line. They are hard to stop.
I think the natural goal scorer is MacKinnon on this line. Rantanen is probably more of a setup guy. He and Landeskog play a lot alike. Bigger bodies, work the corners extremely well, and create lots, whereas MacKinnon is the flash of the line. Yeah. He can go end-to-end, and his shot is, there are very few players in the game who had the release of Nathan MacKinnon. So it's just a perfect line of size, speed, and skill, and they're good luck at stopping them. We talked about them so much last year when they got going, and this year they're continuing.
They're better.
First star of the week's not even on the hot streak. He wasn't even on that list.
Yes, the Colorado Avalanche, a force to be reckoned with offensively. Yeah.
Tries to wrap around, scores!
This is Weekend Wrap Around, my favorite moments from the weekend in the NHL. Let's get right to it, starting with Brett Connolly, who apparently has no time for fist bumps. See Exhibit A. Poor Jacob Vrana. After teaming up with Connolly for a goal, all he wants is to team up for some post-goal appreciation. No dice. It's a nice way to adapt, though, for Vrana. And don't feel bad because you're not his first victim. This is last year. Kuzi just wants a fist bump. Can't get any love. Brett Connolly, all business, and I'm totally here for it. In that same very wild game, we also had some captain-on-captain crime that I refuse to let go underappreciated. Alex Ovechkin with a big-time hit on Alex Barkov, and it's totally clean, so let's just admire it one more time in slow motion, shall we? Thing of beauty. And now I want to watch Rock'em Sock'em. Barkov would also get the last lap in that game, though, scoring this very sick shootout goal. My goodness, that was nice. The Panthers get their first win of the season against the defending Stanley Cup champs, no less. But Saturday doesn't go so well for Mr. Barkov. Yeah, that's a swing and a miss. Turns out Barkov is, in fact, human. Just like the rest of us. Weird weekend for the Finnish captain, though. In Edmonton, the Preds swept their Western Canadian road trip. For that, they were awarded a nice 4 points in the standings. But more importantly, they were awarded this.
We had a challenge to come into Western Canada against two good hockey teams. Take 4 points. And this is the back end of the challenge.
Yep, that's head coach Peter Laviolette as a bull. See, hockey's fun. The mouth moves and everything. You can't make this stuff up. That was funny, but this is just cute. PK Subban with a shout out for his girlfriend after that same game. Sort of, take a listen.
Who are you picking in the Lake Louise downhill this year?
Lake Louise downhill? Lindsay the Bomb Vaughn. That's who I'm taking. So I know she's watching at home, so. Lindsay, let's go. If you're at home, I mean, make sure Lucy gets her. She's got to get to bed soon. Lindsay, go to bed. All right.
Thanks, PK.
Yeah.
I can only assume Lucy is their dog or cat, but I'm really hoping that they're dog people. Please don't be cat people. Anyways, moving right along, the Kings didn't give their fans much to cheer about on Saturday, but referee Francois St. Laurent, oh, he sure did with this serious snag.
good form. Two hands.
Is that like a majorette? You know, the old twirling the baton. And here it goes, here it goes, here it goes. Watch him pick it up. Okay. Circus act time. Oh, use two hands. Come on, I gotta use one. Give a little twirl.
What do you want from the guy? That was a nice catch. It earned Francois the biggest cheer of the day, and that makes me kind of jealous because there was none of that catching nonsense going on for my fantasy football team this weekend. I'll tell you that. All right, last but certainly not least, oh baby, the Sens paid tribute to the career of legendary Bob Cole this weekend. Not every play-by-play guy gets a send-off typically reserved for a player. That's when you know you're a beauty. What a career. Thank you, Bob Cole, for bringing games to life.
Thank you, Jackie. Let's go up to Winnipeg. The Winnipeg Jets hosting the St. Louis Blues tonight at the Bell MTS Place, 8 o'clock Eastern Time. Rematch, season opener. The Jets hammered the Blues. Jets have won two in a row. And the Blues, with a really nice performance against the Toronto Maple Leafs in Toronto, getting a victory there on Saturday night. Joining us to preview, Mitchell Clinton, the Jets TV reporter. And Mitchell, thanks for your time. Got to start the Jets. They've got 6 points, or excuse me, they've netted points in six of their first eight games. Jets seemingly still looking for their A game. What have the players had to say about finding their identity this season?
You know, it's been an interesting point of conversation, just even after those couple of games that you mentioned. They're going to game five of a six-game homestand tonight against St. Louis. And it was something that after the game against Arizona, Blake Wheeler said, you know, it's a thing that's going to take all season to be to build and continue building. So experiences like the one that they had against the Los Angeles Kings, where they were able to hold on to a lead. They go and play against the Edmonton Oilers. The Oilers come back and beat the Jets in overtime. They talked after the game that, you know, maybe last season that's something that they locked down. They said they have to relearn all those lessons again. As much as there's a number of familiar faces on this team, there's still some lessons that that have to be learned, and that was one of them. And then, of course, they go into the game against Arizona. They have that 3-1 third period lead. And they turn that into 2 points, exactly how they would want to do. So it's going to take a little bit. And just in terms of shots against, that's another thing they maybe want to look into preventing. They'll give up the outside shot all day. Defensively, they want to make sure that they close up on those seam passes and not allow those through. But in terms of shot against, they want to kind of avoid those stretches, kind of like where they had against Arizona in the first period, where Arizona was out shooting them 13-2. The shots ended up being close by the end of the game anyways, but those little things are the things that they're working on, building towards that identity.
Yeah, expectations certainly raised this year. The Jets came into the season as a cup contender with lots of offensive threats. How is Paul Maurice, how does he think about getting contributions up and down the lineup? Has he been seeing that so far?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, early on at the start of the season, of course, you had guys like Kyle Connor who came out of the gates real strong. But even in the game against Arizona and a couple of games before that against Vancouver, you started to see guys that, you know, weren't Patrick Laine or Mark Scheifele get involved. The game against Arizona, you had 7 points from defenseman Josh Morrissey being one of those, Jacob Trouba and Tyler Myers being the others that were involved in that. And then you even look at the line with Kopp, Lowry, Tanev. Adam Lowry has 4 goals this season. He didn't hit that mark until December 7th last year. And then Andrew Kopp got in on the score sheet against Vancouver. Ben Chiarot from the back end as well. Dustin Byfuglien also has chipped in offensively. So they're starting to get contributions from all over the lineup. And I think that it's going to be offense that is sustainable, because you look at that Kopp-Lowry-Tanev line. They play defense. They may be the Jets' checking line, but they play defense by playing in the offensive zone. And more often than not, it's Jacob Trouba, Josh Morrissey paired with them. So anytime that you're looking for sustained offensive zone pressure, which is something that Lowry line does very well, oftentimes the back end is a big factor in keeping that puck in.
You mentioned Josh Morrissey. He signed the bridge contract in the offseason. He's creating kind of a name for himself on the Jets' blue line. His offensive game has been a factor this year. He's getting much more power play time through some injuries, but he's really managing to make the best of it. How is his season unfolding here? What is different about his game in year number three?
Well, he's a really great player to watch, only because, you know, he came into the league before he was even drafted by the Winnipeg Jets. That offensive side that you see there when he scores against Arizona, that was always there. But what Paul Maurice has kind of talked about is the confidence to make these plays, like that one to Brian Little that you're seeing. You know, to jump into that hole and come up that left wing – against when you're up against the opposition's best, sometimes that can be a little bit difficult to do when you're just, you know, finding your way in the National Hockey League. But this season, he seems to be more than willing to jump up in the play. And then you mentioned he's on the power play unit. He's on the number one power play unit. I mean, he's playing with Blake Wheeler, Patrick Laine, Mark Scheifele, and Kyle Connor. And the one thing about him on that unit is he's the only left shot. So Patrick Laine, of course, sits in that left circle. If you have a defenseman that's got the left-hand shot that can make the play over to Patrick Laine even a slight bit quicker, I mean, that's all the time a guy like Laine needs. So Josh Morrissey's been a lot of fun to watch in the early going, leading the team in assists and tied for the team lead in points with 7.
The number 8 has been hanging in the rafters at the Honda Center since 2015. Number 8, of course, is not the number of Paul Kariya, but of Teemu Selanne. For many longtime Ducks fans, it's an odd look. Number 8 up there without Paul Kariya's number 9? The two, after all, are the best duo to ever wear the Ducks logo, and the success they achieved together can't be understated. It also cannot be denied that Paul Kariya, the first ever Mighty Duck, had an impact on the game far bigger than his 300 goals. Here's what he had to say about having his number retired.
Back in 1993, I sat in the stands at the Quebec Coliseum, nervously waiting to hear which team would call my name at the NHL entry draft. As I've looked back on my career, there have been many fortuitous things that have happened to me, but being selected by the Mighty Ducks of Anaheim was one of the biggest. As a young player, I fell in love with the speed of the game and the skills and physicality needed to play it. But what I was most attracted to was being a part of a team where everyone contributes towards a common goal. Thank you to my teammates for looking after me on and off the ice, for making me a better player, and most importantly, for the bonds and friendships we have that will last a lifetime. I share this honor with all of you tonight. There's a saying in our sport that you can either be a skate guy or a stick guy. But if you're both, you're gonna be in for a lot of problems. Well, I was a skate guy and I was a stick guy. In short, I was unquestionably the highest maintenance player in NHL history. So the biggest thank you of the night goes to all the equipment managers and trainers who had the unfortunate task of working with me. Thank you to all the fans for supporting me for 9 incredible years. Thank you for supporting the team and the Ducks organization for 25 seasons. And thank you for making tonight the most memorable night of my life. Thank you very much.
Well deserved. Congratulations to Paul Kariya for the honor. I wanted to point out a quote to you guys from the OC Register that I read this morning that I think just sounds so much like Paul Kariya. He said, "I would never consider myself to be deserving of any recognition and certainly nothing of this magnitude. I'm still wrapping my head around it. Growing up, when we played team sports, if we ever said we didn't get enough ice time or we didn't play enough in lacrosse or whatever, that was shut down in a heartbeat." He went on to say, he was referring to his parents, he went on to say, "I would never ever think or say I was deserving of anything like this, and I don't think that will ever change."
Pretty humble.
That's a heck of a quote.
Pretty humble guy, right?
Very humble, but very well deserving. Yeah.
You were talking about when you were playing in Boston when he was at Maine. He only played there, I guess, for a little more than a year at Maine. His freshman year, he had over 100 points. He had 100 points, which is like mind-boggling to put up 100 points in, what, a 40-game college season. But what were they saying about him at that time?
Well, this was, you got to remember, this was well before internet. We couldn't just, you know, go on the internet and pick up games, pick up highlights. I mean, you had to really search to find highlights. And everybody on the East Coast was saying, you got to see this kid playing up in Maine. He's unbelievable. And he was unbelievable
then.
Turned out to be unbelievable. The one thing that, you know, this isn't on the ice related. Paul Kariya's training regime was well before its time. We always talk about back in the day of the 70s when the Russians, the way they trained and the way they played the game. And Paul Kariya did that before he got with the Blackbirds. The way he trained, And everybody does yoga now. Everybody does the stretching. And that's how he trained and strengthened himself. Wasn't a big guy. And in the 90s, it was all about coming into camp, lifting weights, how many bench press you could do, how many pull-ups you could do. It was all about being big, bigger and stronger. Eric Lindros was the guy that you had to try to match up with. And Paul Kariya's training regime is pretty much what players do in today's game, about core strength, about from the knees to pretty much your chest. And the strength of your core is what is necessary to be successful in the game. He did it. I remember talking with Joe Sakic when I was in Colorado, a good friend of Paul Kariya's, and Joe Sakic did a lot of that training. But it's amazing how his training allowed him to be the player he was. I mean, his ability to skate and stop and turn on a dime and the wrist shot that he had, but his skating and his power was all the core strength. And he eluded everybody because he was so much better and well-conditioned, more well-conditioned than others. And that's one thing I'll always remember with Paul Kariya was that not on the ice, but his off-ice training regime allowed him to be the player who I hated trying to catch.
Wonderful, wonderful.
You couldn't catch.
A wonderful player, and just a shame that he had the injury issues in his career because he could have done even more.
Yeah, ahead of his time, and he might not say he deserves it, but everyone else and their mother will say that he does.
Even their mother.
Yes, and even their mother.
Their mother.
Congratulations again to Paul Kariya. All right, this is a new segment. EJ came up with this one, so I'm going to give credit where credit is due.
I don't know
this is
how
called
new it is, but
Getting to Know You. It has a title, I guess I should say. A few young players that we should take notice of around the league. We'll start with Max Comtois.
Yeah, we've got some of these guys. I mean, every year it happens, right? The teams give opportunity, the guys are hurt, and young players get an opportunity. And Max was a second round pick, and he has come in. He's played very, very well. He's been playing with Adam Henrique for most of the year, playing on the left side. But he's a big-bodied kid. He's been able to score. You see him right there all revved up. Takes the body. He's physical. The question will be, when they get everybody healthy, can he stay? But it looks like, Dave, that he has found a spot in Anaheim.
And he's got another year of junior eligibility.
That's right.
So he can go back to Victoriaville in the QMJHL and play. And because of some injuries to players and because of Nick Ritchie's contract situation where he wasn't signed as a left winger, they needed left wingers.
Yeah.
And Maxime Comtois came in and scored in his first minute of his first game.
Which
and
is
all
bad.
Of a sudden, it's like, hey, you know, this guy's not too bad. So here's a young player who took an opportunity and made the best of it. And now he is forcing the hand of Anaheim to say, do you keep me? That 10 games, that 9-game situation is coming close. Yeah. Is he going to play? But he's contributing. And
yes, he is
contributing on a team that is struggling to score goals and needs wins. That's going to be a very, very
and he's
difficult
physically
situation.
Big enough.
Yes, he is.
To play in this league.
6'2", I mean, he's got a 2'10". You're absolutely right.
He's a big kid, so there's no worry about the size there. It'll be interesting to see what they do, but I really like the way he's been playing.
All right, how about Maxime? Speaking of Maxes.
Yes.
Another sort of Maxime Lajoie. Sense
Lajoie.
Fans getting to know him very quickly.
Yeah, and again, opportunity has knocked in Ottawa, and this young man has really delivered so far. The 4 goals, 7 points in the 7 games. Look at that, tied for the most goals among defensemen in the National Hockey League right now. He's 133rd overall pick in 2016, 20 years old. And Dave, last year, he played in the American Hockey League. He actually had 1 game in the ECHL. He scored only 1 goal in the American League all year long. He comes to the National Hockey League. Now he has 4 already. And, doing some homework on him as a younger player. Had some injury issues during his junior career, but he seems to be healthy and really enjoying getting the opportunity to play at this level.
The loss of Erik Karlsson has allowed minutes for other players to step up and play in situations they may not. Now, Lajoie is averaging just under 21 minutes. He's third on the team in ice time behind Thomas Chabot and behind Cody Ceci. So for a young player to come in and get the opportunity to play almost 21 minutes a game, when Erik Karlsson has just left and the whole city of Ottawa is going, oh my gosh, what are we going to do on the back end? Well, Chabot was supposed to be the guy to step up and be the offensive catalyst. He has done that, but Lajoie has been absolutely tremendous in this situation. But another player given an opportunity on taking full advantage of this opportunity and, allowing him to get noticed by you, EJ. and by everybody in the hockey world. How do you not notice these young players? No, who normally it might take a little bit
more. That's true. If Ottawa was in a different place, yes,
he's in the minors still.
Yes,
he's in the minors still.
If Erik Karlsson's there, he's not going to get the extra look, the extra game. Well, he got those. He's taken advantage of it. And congratulations. I mean, that's well deserving. And he's playing as though he's been here for years.
He really has.
Which is really remarkable.
He's played a lot with Chris Weidman. And, you know, the Ottawa Senators have been a surprise, and it's because of players like this.
All right, one more for you. Henry Jokiharju. Nailed it.
Jokiharju, yes.
Had to practice that one.
This really, you know, it's funny. He's another 19-year-old. He was a 29th overall pick by the Blackhawks in 2017, playing a lot with Duncan Keith. Playing, look at that, over 21 minutes a game. Second among rookies. He was a gold medal winner with Team Finland at the World Juniors in 2016, and he's played the last couple years with Portland in the Western Hockey League, so he's been over here playing. And last year, Dave, the numbers in Portland, 63 games, 71 points, 12 goals. So this is someone they drafted high and is coming in, and he's been a factor so far.
I have this one figured out. I know why he's doing
all right.
Well. He hasn't woken up yet. He still thinks he's in Portland. Yeah. You know why? Because it's the Portland Winterhawks.
That's
you
right.
You know the jerseys of the Portland Winterhawks? It looks like the Chicago Blackhawks.
That's a good
so
point.
He hasn't figured it out that he's playing with
crowds,
Duncan
though.
Keith and bigger, the Chicago Blackhawks.
Maybe crowds.
Maybe he's got blinders on. He hasn't woken up yet. No, I'm still in Portland. You know, I'm still playing for Mike Johnson in Portland. We're having fun. I'm playing junior hockey. Well,
who's the older guy with Duncan
Keith? Yeah, who is that guy?
Yeah,
and he's not passing me the puck. But anyhow, it's, again, remarkable. A young player getting an opportunity. Chicago needed defensemen.
Yes, they do.
And
yes,
this is a great opportunity for young players to come in. There's a reason he was drafted in the first round. We're seeing it now because of his poise and his confidence on the ice. I mean, you go out and you start playing with guys like Duncan Keith, there's usually a little panic in your game. Not necessarily on the ice with him, but you're watching him from the bench, and you're like, oh, my gosh, I'm in the National Hockey League. We don't see any of that with young guys. We're talking about Lajoie, Comtois, and now Jokiharju. This is very good. This is great for the Chicago Blackhawks because this is
what they need.
Puck-moving defenseman who's got confidence and can play in all situations.
And they need it. Yeah, exactly. Need young players as they have some older guys there. Think about who gets to learn from. He gets to play with Keith.
Yeah.
He gets to listen to maybe Brent Seabrook from time to time.
He's got Coach Q.
He's got Coach Q. I mean, I think this is a great situation for him. And, again, give their scouting staff a lot of credit. I mean, we'll see how things play out over time. But 29th overall pick, and those are the guys. You want those guys to come in and play for your team, and so far, so good.
Yeah, all three of those guys just seem like young players that were ready for the opportunity when it presented itself. Not always the case, but luckily for them in this case, that was the case.
Joining us now, the Islanders general manager, Lou Lamoriello. And Lou, you have a relationship with Charles Wong that dates back to well before your time with the Islanders. Give us the background of how you guys got to know one another.
Well, I met Charles some 20 years ago at the Board of Governors meetings. And because of the way the room was set up in alphabetical order, I sat next to him for each and every meeting. And we established a friendship and a relationship that's been ongoing since day one. And stayed in communication, whether I was in New Jersey or Toronto, and as well as here today at the island. So he's a dear friend, a unique individual who had visions that were beyond a lot of people, and he's going to be sadly missed.
What was special about Charles and your relationship? What was something that made him stand out to you? You mentioned some of those qualities. Give us a little bit more insight.
Well, he had a wit about him that, you know, had a way of either getting to you or making you try and understand, you know, what and where he was going with maybe whatever decision he might have, because he was an out-of-the-box thinker. He looked at things in a unique way and tried to be different, not intentionally, just be different to come to the same conclusions we all try and come to as far as success. So he was an interesting study because when you're with him for an amount of time, you know, you sometimes were wondering if he was setting you up, if he was just teasing you or having fun. But there was a method to his madness, and it's evident with the type of success he's had, you know, in the business world. And I think what really goes unnoticed, the philanthropic commitment he has made to the community, to Long Island, and in particular nationally, the Smile Train.
How should Islander fans remember Charles Wong? I mean, he was an owner of this team for quite a while.
Well, I think they can remember him in many ways. If they're strictly a fan, he, in my opinion, is the sole person responsible for the Islanders staying on the island when they went through some real hardships, if we recall, with reference to changes of ownership when John Pickett had sold it. There were some real tough times. And when Charles came in, stabilized it, maybe the commitment. This was his home. He wanted to make sure that the Islanders were here to stay. And it's an indication is that when he did decide to sell it, the type of people that he singled out that he would want to be a partner with, because he wanted to stay involved, his love of the game and in love of the players that are involved and the fans was just unmeasurable.
Well, there's no question he loves that team and loved the franchise. I want to ask you, Lou, how would he feel about this group so far this season? Because it seems like you guys, it's been some ups and downs, but there's been some good, and seems like things are moving in the right direction.
Well, I think he would feel as he's always felt about the players and about the team. He'd feel good. He'd always take the positive approach. He'd always look at the glass half full. And that's the way he approached his life, and that's the way he approached his vision in sports.
All right, Lou, thanks so much for your time. We appreciate it. I know it's a tough day for you and for everyone affiliated with the Islanders. Thanks again.
Thank you.
We say hello to Joey Kenward. Big day for Jay Beagle. He must be excited.
Well, yeah, and actually it's been a big couple of days for him because him and his wife brought in a baby girl into the world a couple of days ago. So it's been frustrating for him starting off with the Canucks. He's got a fracture in his hand and his forearm, so he won't be able to play his former teammates tonight. But when you bring in a new family member and when you get delivered some new bling, no surprise he's been smiling ear to ear today here as the Canucks get set to take on the Caps.
Yes, two of the biggest achievements in his life, his kids and, of course, his Stanley Cup ring. All right, the Canucks have flown a bit under the radar here, off to a pretty good start this season. What's the reaction like surrounding this team? Are there people within the organization that are surprised by the start they've had?
Well, they had a really good start at this time last year. I think they took points in 7 of their first 10, Jackie. And coming out of the gates, 5-3, considering they've only played 2 times here in Rogers Arena. Yeah, they've got a lot of things to be happy about right now. They've gotten great goaltending. They've got some good scoring. And Bo Horvat, who you see here netting the winner Saturday in the overtime victory over Boston, he's got 5 goals on the season. Player like Nikolai Goldobin, he's chipping in offensively. And you know what? That's a key to Vancouver. Trying to have a big bounce back year, they need to have a lot of things go well. They've got to spread out their scoring. They've got to be good on special teams. But maybe most importantly, they have to be much better defensively. And so far, against some pretty high-powered offensive teams that they've faced through 8 games, they've done a pretty good job.
All right, let's talk about Brock Besser, because he certainly had a Calder-worthy season last year. And had it not been for a bit of an injury and Matt Barzal, he might have actually won it. What has he had to say about avoiding the cliche sophomore slump this season?
Yeah, he's done a pretty good job, I think, of blocking out that quote-unquote white noise. Took him a while to get his first goal of the season. There was a lot of people in these parts that were wondering, is Brock destined for a sophomore jinx? But there you saw his goal against Pittsburgh, and he was able to capitalize as well in overtime earlier this season. This guy's a shooter. This guy, remember, didn't have as long a training offseason as a lot of would coming off that surgery on his shoulder, or on his arm, excuse me. So he's a guy that the fans are keeping fingers crossed can just carry on right where he left off last year. There you see his totals so far. This season, a player that's a shooter, he's going to be a big-time threat on the power play for the Canucks, and a guy that certainly caught the attention of teams around the NHL. They now circle his name on that lineup board whenever Vancouver takes on an opponent.
Oh, yeah, there is no doubt about that. His teammate, Bo Horvat, also off to a good start this year, 2 seasons after being named an All-Star. What adjustments has he made to his game, if any, that have allowed him to elevate things to the next level?
Well, I mentioned the fact he's had a great start. 5 goals through his first 8 games, netting the winner here against Boston Saturday night. A player that many around these parts and around the league think will be the next team captain for the Canucks. Vancouver started this year without putting the C on the jersey of any one of their players, but he'll wear an A, and I think if he can just keep going on this direction that he's on right now, we're going to see him be the next team captain to succeed Henrik Sedin. It might not be till next season, might not even be until the season after that, but he's a very, very good start to his year for the Canucks. And in the absence of Daniel and Henrik Sedin, they need players to pick up the slack offensively, and this is a player that many think can do just that here on the West Coast.
And those are big shoes to fill, so I think it's the right decision by the Canucks to wait a little bit before they make that decision. Well, Joey, I can't have you on here without asking about Elias Pettersson, because Twitter will own me. Obviously, Canucks fans very upset to see him go down with a concussion. What's the latest on his status?
Well, and rightly so. This kid was arguably the talk of the league when it came to teenagers stepping into the NHL this fall. What a great start, but here you see why he's out. When he was slammed to the ice by Mike Matheson down in Florida a little over a week ago. So he's in concussion protocol. It's good news for Canucks fans. He skated in the morning skate today with the team here as they prepare to take on Washington. The plan is he'll practice tomorrow with the team before they head to Vegas and Arizona for midweek games on the road this week. It's all the logical steps that he needs to try to get back into the lineup as quickly as possible. There you see his numbers. They are eye-popping for a kid that's never played on NHL ice before this month. He's had a great start to Vancouver. Disappointing that he had to be sidelined for now a couple of games, but it looks like he's on the path that fans are keeping their fingers crossed can see him back in the lineup here in short order.
Yeah, sounds like some positive signs, considering concussions could go one way or the other. We never really know when it comes to that type of injury. Thanks for this, Joey. We appreciate it.
Thanks. It's going to be a lot of fun. Never dull when the Cup champs come to town.
No,
here in
I'm
Vancouver.
Sure.
They're one and only time.
Yes, I'm sure the Canucks will be up for this game. That's for sure. Time for this season's first edition of Read Between the Lines with Dave Reed. Will the Leafs make this top 5 list for top lines in the NHL? We'll find out. But we start in the 5 spot with one of their biggest rivals, the Montreal Canadiens.
Yeah, it's interesting. I'm watching the Montreal Canadiens, and I'm not really thinking a lot's going to happen with the Montreal Canadiens. But you put a couple players who are not expected to be possibly first-liners. Thomas Tatar on the left side, Philip Deneau in the middle. Brendan Gallagher hasn't always been a top-line player, but right now in Montreal, this threesome has been playing absolutely stellar. They are combined plus 14 in the plus-minus category. They are contributing in every category, and every player brings something different to the table. Tatar came over from Vegas. He was pretty much a cast-off. Wasn't even playing in the playoffs, but he had success in Detroit. Well, he's a scoring for the Montreal Canadiens early. Kind of not maybe having people forget about Pacioretty, but filling the void. Then Owen in the middle's got good speed, good hockey sense, moves around the ice extremely well. And Gallagher is that type of player who just gets in those gritty areas. This is a fun line to watch. I've got him at number 5. A lot of people, and you're probably one of them, saying, well, how can you not have the Leafs and
wait,
possibly
we got 4 spots left.
But this is number 5, so I'm putting them in ahead of both of the Leafs lines. So I'm not going to have the Leafs lines in there.
Oh,
there's
wow.
One,
spoiler alert already.
Yeah, but there's
okay.
The one line. There is a big line that's not in my top 5. But right now, I like what's going on in Montreal with the Deneau line.
All right. At the number 4 spot, another Canadian team.
Yes. Well, this is another team that I love watching this player play. We talked about him earlier. It's Johnny Gaudreau on the left side. Absolutely dynamic with Sean Monahan in the middle and Elias Lindholm coming over from Carolina on the right side. Now, 5-on-5, this team or this line is at 500. They are plus minus. They're exactly the same. But this line is carrying right now the Calgary Flames. They're scoring at 46.7% of the goals scored by the team. They're dynamic on the power play. Johnny Gaudreau, he's money. You want to go pay money to watch a player play? Well, every time you go to watch Calgary, you're going to enjoy yourself with Johnny Gaudreau. As a line, he and Mona have been together for a few years. We know what they can do. Elias Lindholm coming in from Carolina has really stepped in on this line and added that extra little bit of skill and speed dimension that not necessarily they didn't have, but it's a great fit for this line right now. I've got them at the number four position.
All right, top three. I'm excited. Who's third?
We're moving along. And again, you're giving me these bad looks because I haven't put the Leafs in here.
I get this.
And then a lot of, and I'm surprised you're not looking and saying, well, what's going on with the Boston Bruins here at number three? But the Boston Bruins, a lot of people think this could be your first
they
line.
They are sick.
It's good thing Jameson Coyle's not here because he will be definitely be giving me the bad looks. But this line has been good for a few years with Brad Marchand, Patrice Bergeron, David Pastrnak. They can absolutely dominate a game in both ends of the rink. David Pastrnak, with his 8 goals this season, has been absolutely tremendous. They are a plus 15 as a group. They're scoring 59% of the Bruins' goals.
Ridiculous.
And that is absolutely dominant at times. And it's Pastrnak is the guy who's been getting the highlight reel goals. But the line is driven by the sentiment, Patrice Bergeron. He is so solid in both ends of the rink. He does all the little things extremely well. And Brad Marchand, a setup guy right now where he's going along, he's got 10 assists on the season for 12 points. Both he and Pastrnak are a couple of the top scorers in the National Hockey League. It's tough not to keep that line in your top 2, 3, 4. I mean, I think they're probably going to be there all season long. They're just that good. They were there last year,
hey.
And it's going to be tough to knock that group out of the top.
Even line. I can admit, they are filthy. They are so good. Okay, number two.
Number two. Now, this is a bit of a surprise, and we talked about Elias Lindholm going to Calgary. Well, on this line in Carolina with Sebastian Aho in the middle, we've got Michael Ferland is on the left side. He was involved in that trade, and Ferland brings in, EJ was talking about him earlier in the day, he brings in that grit to this line. Sebastian Aho is absolutely tremendous. He scored a point in each of his team's games, and Teuvo Teravainen is a nice fit on the other side, not the goal scorer, and it's Michael Ferland, a little surprised that he's scoring all these goals, but he's getting to areas that Carolina needed players to get to areas, these areas before he's brought that little sandpaper, that push to the line. Sebastian Aho is really stepping in to what everybody expected him to be when he was playing in Finland as an 18-year-old, as a 20-year-old in his draft year. He's an absolutely dominant player when he's on the ice. And Teuvo Teravainen, more of a sniper, more known as a sniper, but right now he's a setup guy. This line has been great for Carolina. They've been a dominant team at times. They're a lot of fun to watch, and one of the great surprises of this year is Carolina, and that's why I've got them at number two.
They certainly have been a big surprise. All right, we're at the number one spot now. Joke's over.
Oh,
it's
yeah,
the Leafs, right?
Yeah,
No,
but a lot of people are saying, well, how come Dallas isn't in there? Where's Sagan, Ben, and Radulov? How good?
Those
I would put them. I'm putting them ahead of the two Leaf lines. So that's with Matthews, of course, and John Tavares.
All right, neither
of those three lines are in there. I'm going with the best line in hockey right now. We saw this line throughout the show. I mean, come on, seriously. Nathan MacKinnon in the middle with Gabriel Landeskog, the first star of the week, and Mikko Rantanen. MacKinnon and Rantanen have got point streaks, 8-game point streaks. They've scored a point in every game so far this season for their team. They have an opportunity to tie a record set by Joe Sakic and Anton Stastny back in 88-89 for a pair of teammates in Colorado franchise record to start a season. These guys are incredible. MacKinnon's got such great speed, such great release on a shot, and you've got big bodies in Landeskog, the captain, who can work the corner so well and can be physical. And Rantanen, a setup guy, fantastic shot, but the combination of these three players, we saw it last year and how good these guys can be at any time, whether it's power play, whether it's 5-on-5, they can be a dominant force. And right now, in my mind, they're the best line in the National Hockey League.
And we've had superstars on this show, like Steven Stamkos last year, talk about the importance of every player on the line understanding their role. And I think Colorado is a very, very good example of three players who all very much understand their part in how to be successful with each other.
And when you've got three players understanding the role and they've got the skill level that these three players possess,
you get those crazy numbers.
Good luck could stop him. Absolutely crazy numbers. And it's going to be tough to stop these guys.
There's a new book out, and it chronicles a full year of great hockey stories. It's called Hockey 365 Daily Stories from the Ice, and it's written by Mike Comito, who also happens to be the team historian for the Sudbury Wolves of the OHL. Mike joins us now, and Mike, thanks for the time. We appreciate it.
My pleasure. Thanks.
This isn't an easy task to go through a whole year of hockey. How did you come up with the idea, and how did you put it all together selecting things?
No, you're right. It's certainly, there's a lot of milestone moments to choose throughout hockey history. So, I mean, you had the big moments like when Gretzky scored His 1,851st point to pass Gordie Howe for the all-time scoring lead. And you had some other big moments that kind of loom large in hockey history. But you're right, I think to kind of fill in the spaces between, especially in the offseason and the dog days of summer, when you're kind of limited to transactions and signings, I think the key for me was to just try to go back and find stories that would resonate with the readers. Even if they weren't those big milestone moments, was to try to pull out the interesting facts and, maybe some characteristics about those players and the career they had, not only leading up to that moment that's highlighted in the book, but the career that kind of came afterwards.
All right. So today is October 22nd. What happened today in history that's in your book?
Yeah. So today, if you were to crack open the book, you would find on that page is actually Bobby Hull's first goal. And the reason why I included Hull's first goal is because, again, this is somebody who, you know, becomes synonymous with the slap shot. You know, he was known for racing in on goaltenders and terrorizing them, you know, with his blistering slap shot. But the reason why I included this one is because not only would he go on to score 609 more NHL career goals, but this one was interesting because he didn't actually score. It was a game against the Bruins, and he was actually just the last Blackhawks player to touch the puck. It was actually Jack Bionda, a Bruins defenseman, who had inadvertently put the puck into his net. So, again, a very inconspicuous start for Hull, but certainly the first goal in many.
All right. Well, you're right about that. I mean, Bobby Hull, he figured it out pretty quick, but that's a good one. Yeah. I like that. How do you decide? Like, because, like, you know, some dates you probably don't have a lot of choice, but there's others, you know, that there are many things happening. Like, for example, March 23rd, you had to choose between the fastest hat trick ever and then Wayne Gretzky scoring 802. How do you make a decision there?
Yeah, so that was a tough one for me. Again, obviously, because Gretzky's 802nd goal to pass, you know, his boyhood idol, Gordie Howe, is obviously a notable moment in hockey history. But I had dealt with it in various ways throughout the book. When I talked about Marty McSorley and his time with the Oilers and the Kings, I mentioned that, you know, he was the one that assisted on Gretzky's milestone goal. So it's touched on in different ways. And, I mean, for me, you know, Bill Mozyanko, because of the fact that Gretzky, you know, he had his milestone moment basically to the day 40 years later, you know, it's kind of overshadowed. I mean, 3 goals in 21 seconds is certainly an incredible feat, and I think it deserves to be highlighted as well. So I think there's a trade-off there that, especially with players like Gretzky, they loom large throughout the narrative. So, I mean, I wanted to ensure that it wasn't Gretzky 365, and so I tried to spread the ice time around as much as I could.
Yeah, there's your next book, Gretzky 365. Yeah. I'm sure you could probably come up with things every day that Wayne has done, but I think that's a good choice. 3 goals in 21 seconds. I don't know if we're ever going to see something like that again. Probably not. Some days, you know, like when you go through a book like this, there's days that affect you personally. And there was one in particular that we know on Austin Matthews. When he made his debut, he had 4 goals in that game. And it was a memorable day kind of for you. Give us the backstory there.
Yeah, so certainly. So again, obviously it was a milestone moment in hockey history. Again, he was the first player in the modern era to score 4 goals in his debut. But for me, it held some special significance. My daughter Zoe was actually born 2 weeks earlier. And I am a Leafs fan through and through. And so it was actually the first hockey game that Zoe and I got to spend together. And again, she didn't watch any of it. She was, of course, 2 weeks old. So she was sleeping, but she was wearing these Maple Leafs pajamas that were far too big for her. But I insisted that she sport them anyway, because it was, after all, the first Leafs game of the season. And so that for me is a special moment where, you know, that's something I look forward to talking to her about when she's a little bit older. And it's really the only moment in the book where I kind of insert myself in the narrative. I try to let the hockey history story speak for themselves. But I figured with something like that, that has a personal connection, I thought I would, take some liberty there and include myself.
That's terrific. And when she signs with the Leafs someday, you can have that picture of her in those Leafs pajamas. It would be perfect. We think we've seen that once or twice before. Last thing I got to ask you, Mike, was there any one date, particularly again in the summer, was there one date that really was tough for you to find a really something that you wanted to include?
To be honest, it wasn't too bad in the summer because I think you had slim pickings. And so it really just kind of, you had to just do your homework and do the backstory on the players or the transaction that happened that day to really kind of build a case as to why, that player merits inclusion. Again, you had some days where you're maybe picking between 4 or 5 different moments that I was able to find through the course of my research versus, you know, during the regular season, there's no shortage of moments throughout the year from when the season starts in October until when we now see it end in June. So there wasn't really anything that I had trouble including. I think the summer was great because it allowed you to kind of, you know, look at some interesting moments. Again, in June, you had the time when the Rangers traded their first round pick for a coach, which again is something that's, you know, hasn't happened since. And it's certainly an interesting moment in hockey history. So I think it's just it wasn't as bad as I thought to try to fill up those dog days of summers.
There's plenty to work with, I'm sure. Hockey 365, great new book. Hockey fans out there, hey, the holidays are coming up. This is must have. Yeah. Mike, thanks for your time. We really appreciate it.
Thanks, EJ. Appreciate it.
Tonight in Philly, it'll be the second and final meeting between the Flyers and the Avalanche on October 6th. It was the Avs with a 5-2 win. The Flyers will try to even the score tonight. And joining us to preview the action is the Flyers TV voice, Jim Jackson. And Jim, Flyers set to take on a very difficult Avalanche team tonight. How do they plan to slow down that explosive top line that includes the league's first star of the week, Gabe Landeskog?
Well, a lot of prayer would certainly help, EJ. That line has been as hot as any line in the NHL right now, piling up the points here. Obviously, the first star of the week, as you mentioned, but Nathan MacKinnon with all that speed. And I talked with Ivan Provorov today about it, and he said the key is you have to basically have really good reads on the play so that you're not flat-footed. If you're flat-footed with MacKinnon, he's going to blow by you. And then obviously he's got great wingers. They can finish. And also you got a guy like Landeskog who does all the dirty work for the line. Rantanen's an outstanding playmaker. So it's a complete line. The Flyers' basic plan is obviously to spend time in the offensive zone when they're on the ice. Flyers are the best team in the league in faceoffs right now. They want to have the puck in the Colorado zone and make those three guys spend time trying to keep the puck out of their own net as opposed to putting it in the Flyers' net.
Jim, the Flyers changed their D pairs in the last game. The biggest change was Provorov and Gostisbehere separated. I like that move. I don't know why they were together in the first place, but the team responded with their best defensive effort of the season on Saturday, a 5-2 win over the Devils. So would they stay the same tonight?
They do. And the reason they were together, EJ, is they put them together last year, about halfway through the year or so, and the team really took off. It really seemed to help the club. But so far this year, the pair had struggled some. I mean, I think we focus a lot on these two guys. I mean, they're so uberly talented that we're always looking for them to be spectacular every night. I mean, they are human. But I think in splitting them up, what Dave Hextall has done is he's put a puck mover with a kind of stay-at-home defenseman in each of the three pairs now, and that's a pretty good mix. Goes to playing with Christian Follin and Ivan Provorov and Robert Haig as a pair. And I think he's hoping that with a balance set that way defensively, that it'll be good for the club. I wouldn't be shocked to see Ghost and Provorov back together at some point this season, but for right now, I think it's good for the club, and certainly it was on Saturday.
Yeah, it was a very good performance against the Devils in that victory. Flyers have also, here's a new story, right? They've had some struggles in net this season, currently holding the lowest team save percentage. Who gets the nod tonight?
It's Brian Elliott, and he played well in the game Saturday against the Devils. You know, you look at the save percentage, and it isn't good. That's true. Early in the year, though, these guys were really getting pucks fired at them from every angle. The Flyers were not playing well defensively. There were a couple games recently where the goaltending wasn't where I think the Flyers wanted it to be. The loss in Columbus comes to mind, and also a game which they actually won against Florida. But when they played better defense in front of them, big surprise, right? The goaltending looked better the other day against the Devils. So they're hoping to see that more of that, although obviously the Avalanche right now are scoring a lot of goals. So the Flyers are going to have to find a way to get some saves from Brian Elliott. Brian Elliott's a guy who throughout his career has been a solid goaltender, but it seems like all the Flyer goalies are either coming off surgery or have had some kind of injury issue here early in the season. So it's been tough to find a guy to just jump on and ride. They're hoping Elliott will be that guy. Eventually, maybe Michael Neuvert will be back. He's injured right now. They picked up Pickard, of course, and they have some other guys playing, younger guys down in the American Hockey League, too. But for now, Brian Elliott is the guy they're looking to.
Well, the goalies need help like everybody else. They can't do it alone. We'll see how Brian Elliott fares tonight. Here's a question for you from Twitter.
Yes.
It comes from FlyGuy73. What is the delay with Carter Hart? Is there a financial/contract reason to him not being up? I just don't see the logic. Well, there is a lot of logic here. Explain to FlyGuy73. Yeah.
The delay, he's played all of four professional games. He's 20 years old. 20 years old, EJ, and as you know, goaltenders obviously need some kind of seasoning, maybe more so than any other player. Ron Hextall spent 2 years in the minors before he burst upon the NHL scene. Martin Brodeur spent a full season in the minors before he became a spectacular goaltender. Carter Hart's a talented goalie, but he needs a little time to get his feet wet at the professional level. And so that's what he's going to get this year. The Flyers certainly have plenty of other goalies. They got to find somebody to get hot. But for right now, it has nothing to do with finances. It's just about trying to get Carter Hart settled at the professional level. And then at some point, he'll make it here to the NHL level and be better prepared.
All right, Jim, thanks for your time. Flyers and Avs tonight should be a really good game.
Should be. Looking forward to it.